I think they're not necessarily damaging to me, but I feel like they could definitely be damaging to a lot of people on the internet. And you've got to be careful because, you know, I think influencers and content creators do have to take responsibility for the content they are promoting and producing. So, slightly different approach to YouTube Shorts today, and we're actually going to be looking at something that YouTube has told me to look at. So, I was scrolling through the old studio page, and up popped 5 shorts, and they were all under the category of shorts that you guys have apparently been watching. So, firstly, I'm going to expose what kind of shorts that the majority of my audience are watching, and also, I'm going to talk about the shorts that you seem to consume yourself, and give my opinion on them. So, it's going to be fun, a bit different, and a bit interesting. I burned 1,000 calories in one workout. One of the things here to note, the kind of calories that you're treadmill or your machine is telling you that you're burning isn't always going to be accurate. Sure, it can be used as like a rough guideline of how many calories you may be burning, but there are so many variables that are different from person to person, it's not necessarily accurate. So if it tells you you're burning 1,000 calories, you may not be. I understand that videos like this are created largely for the kind of the fun of things and because it's probably quite good for views and stuff, but you've also got to ask yourself, again, I'm not trying to look too much into it, but you do have to ask yourself, is this healthy? And I think for the majority of people, again, depending on your goals, the answer is probably no. So trying to burn 1,000 calories, I get, is fantastic for views. It's probably done all right. I mean, 400,000 views in a month is pretty good. Is it promoting a message to your audience that potentially suggests that this is something they should do, something that could be encouraged, and something, despite what you say or have said in the video, something that may help them achieve their goals? Again, I understand this video is probably for a bit of fun, so I'm not going to look too much into it. But again, I've always got to kind of play devil's advocate and say, what could this do to the audience that are watching it? Whose hands might this fall into? So if somebody is unfortunately battling with something along the lines of an eating disorder or similar, could this further push them to engage in really unhealthy exercise habits or something along those lines? And this is why I've never been a big fan of those. How many calories can I eat in this period, or how many calories can I burn in this period? Because although I get their fun and they're good for views, for me personally, someone who has like an okay relationship with food and exercise, I think they're not necessarily damaging to me, but I feel like they could definitely be damaging to a lot of people on the internet. And you've got to be careful because, you know, I think influence and content creators do have to take responsibility for the content they are promoting and producing. We love dumbbell squats, do we? Let's find out. This is why you hear so many girls say they love dumbbell sumo squats for the glutes, and you hear so many people say it's not that good of an exercise. So it's not the wide stance that does anything special, but the natural position you get into to grab the dumbbell hinges your hips back while you lean forward and creates the perfect, I guess, like 90 degree mark, like knee above ankle for glute bias. Interesting. This makes you do it naturally, but if you keep this in mind, you can keep that hinge on a lot of your leg movements. Feel it in your glutes all the time. So a few things to know that I think, again, it's fine. The only issue with like dumbbell sumo squats, or one of the big issues I should say, grip often becomes a bit of a limiting factor. How much you can load this movement becomes a bit of a limiting factor. Therefore, it almost arguably reduces how far you can push the movement, which is always a consideration when you're looking at like resistance-based movements. But I think if you want to include it, you certainly can. I just don't know if it's something I would personally include or favor in like a glute program I was writing. Again, maybe here and there, and depending on the person, obviously, but I probably favor things like a split squat. I probably favor things like an RDL, a hip thrust, hyperextensions, glute med kickbacks, so many things along those lines, lunges, high stance leg presses. Again, not all in one session. I'm just saying these are just spitballing some of my preferred glute movements. But no, I mean, if you want to include it, you certainly can. I'm not against it whatsoever. I think, again, just make sure your grip isn't the limiting factor and make sure you're able to load it effectively and for hopefully a long period of time, because ultimately a lot of the best movements are the ones that you can do for a very long period of time and milk them for all they're worth, which is why, for me personally anyway, my training program rarely changes. I do a lot of the same movements for a very long time and get very strong in those movements until my goals change, and then I might change the movements too. Or if I've kind of milked that movement for all it's worth and adaptive resistance has occurred, in which case I've kind of taken it as far as it can go for now, and I probably need to do something else to spice things up a bit temporarily. Point of view, you've been wanting to start Pilates but don't want to spend $ on reformer classes. Oh, interesting. Then you come across this page that shows you all the ways you can do it at home without any equipment, such as using a towel slide. Interesting. That's quite creative, actually. I respect that. No, I think that's quite cool. I thought she was going to try and sell me something, but I don't think she is. Utilizing things around your house like towels and whatever can be really good. Granted, they may not necessarily be as good as the initial equipment like this. There's probably a reason they're found in a lot of gyms and are very popular amongst these Pilates classes. So although obviously implementing towels and bits and bobs around the house is definitely a good time and definitely a big yes, I respect it. It is probably enough to take you so far, but if you want to go a bit further, you may have to consider what's next. I mean, there will also be limitations of you could potentially do certain movements with a towel as a substitute for this equipment, but you probably can't do all of the movements, which again may limit how far this could take you. But again, I think it's definitely a fair substitute for earlier on, perhaps. Watch me transform through my journey. A lot of interesting movements here. This is actually quite a good movement there. Working on the form, I respect it. Interesting. Okay, making progress. Jump squats, bloody wild, jumping much higher than I can. Obviously, there have definitely been some amazing physical changes that have occurred and some massive strength gain. But if nothing else, it's almost really interesting and really cool to see the change in movement selection and movement quality. It's good to see that she's gone from doing some maybe not so great movements to start with and has since progressed to doing a lot more of the more effective movements and a lot more movements that are likely going to take her much further on her journey. So I respect it. I think it's bloody good. I think it's almost just interesting just to see how your training changes over time. And also how the more and more you learn, the more and more your training seems to change because you're again learning what works for you and what doesn't work for you, learning what's effective, maybe what's not so effective, and also learning what you can better do to help you achieve your goals and reach your goals in the most efficient and sustainable means possible. And I respect it. Again, it's gone from some, like I said, some maybe not so spicy movements to start with, some very simple, effective, resistance-based movements afterwards, which has clearly done fantastic bits for her because she's made incredible progress. I love it. I respect it. Very quickly, as always, you know what's occurring. TFNL Community Coaching is always linked down below in the description and also the comment section, in which I create workout programs for you guys to follow together or individually, depending on how you want to do it, and you can be part of a team. You can comment on the sessions, you can join in on the message board and the group discussions, so many things. And actually, if this video does come on the Thursday, which it should, the new training block is actually due to start on Monday, so in a few days from now, which is a new training program. So what better time to start? And it likely costs less than your Netflix subscription, and there's also a 1 week free trial as well. Bloody laughing. Also, on top of that, the TFNL growth guide is always linked down below in the description as well, and the home workout guide is in the works and is going to be coming out very, very soon, which is going to be an add-on to the growth guide. This is going to be an interesting one. I've actually had a few people talk to me about grip before. They say, oh, Harry, when I'm doing this movement, my grip gives out, I don't know what to do. Ultimately, I'd always say your grip is likely going to be a limiting factor in a lot of movements, so I would nearly always recommend lifting straps to help remove grip as that limiting factor, but there are also certain things you can do to improve your grip and train your grip accordingly to strengthen it to make it less of a limiting factor going forward. And we're now going to find out what this individual has to say about that. It can be simply improved by adding hanging into your workouts. I actually respect that. I'm a big fan of dead hangs, and oftentimes I will incorporate or suggest people incorporate dead hangs into their workouts if they're looking at improving their grip strength, partly because it's a good grip movement. It will test your grip and you're going to have to essentially learn to power through the horrendous pain it will cause you, but also it's quite a nice spinal decompression movement because again, there's no compression, you are hanging. I find that quite nice when considering like potential back health, and it certainly helped my back when I was dealing with some issues. Single arm hangs are great to balance out a weakness in one arm. Again, I think single arm hangs are gonna be a lot harder, obviously, because you're shifting all that weight from two hands over to one hand, but I think single arm hangs can be a great progression from doing the regular dead hangs because again, as you get stronger and as you want to kind of make things a bit harder and push that progressive overload a bit more, you can shift it over to one hand. All I would say is if you do one hand at a time, always start with your weaker arm. Always start with it because again, your strong hand or strong arm is going to be able to catch up to the weak one pretty quickly. Your weaker one may not necessarily be able to match whatever your strong one does, therefore potentially enhance how much of a strength gap there is. Use also a mixed grip and supinated grip. Again, with that, I'm not sure because again, I think supinated you can certainly, but most of the movements you're going to be performing are going to be overhand. So I typically try and favor most grip movements to be overhand or neutral. If you're going to do like farmer's walks or things along those lines, mixed grip, I typically try and avoid for everything beyond deadlifts. And even then, I would still favor straps because I've spoken about this many times before, rotational imbalances, things along those lines. I don't think mixed grip is going to be the best course of action when looking at developing grip strength. I would probably, like I said, favor, in most cases, not all cases, double overhand. I'm sure mixed grip certainly can get thrown into mix here and there, but like I said, I would prioritize, for the most part, double overhand grips. The grip strength from hanging can carry over to other grip-dependent movements like deadlifts. Absolutely, I completely agree. Use chalk if you can, absolutely, because again, you get clammy hands, you get sweaty hands, it's gonna make it harder to hold on because you're gonna get slippy. And don't use gloves. Yes, calluses will be your new friend if you want a strong grip. All I'll say with calluses is look after them. So if they develop too much and they become problematic, sometimes if you get like a callus caught when you're deadlifting, it can actually cause the callus to rip off, which will then obviously rip off the dead skin of the callus, but also potentially lead to an open wound, which is not very nice because that can take a little while to heal. And no one wants to be deadlifting when you've got a cut exactly where you're going to hold, because it's going to likely limit how much you can tolerate without being in too much pain. So that's always a bit annoying, but you can buy things like callus care, you can file them down, you can do so many things with them. But all I have to say is just, if you can, look after your calluses, otherwise they may come back to bite you at some point. Again, not always, but it has happened to quite a few people I know, and it's not make or break, it's just quite an inconvenience and can put you off deadlifting for a little bit, again, until it heals. No, I think that was funny. It's definitely interesting looking at names I'm not particularly familiar with. Obviously, I knew a couple of those names, but not all of them or not a lot of them. And it was nice to see what shorts that you guys have apparently been watching. Comment question of the week this week is actually a question for you. This video is likely coming out on Thursday, and I'm actually potentially filming a video with Maddie R Fitness on Saturday, and I'd like you to comment any questions you may have for us, as we're going to answer some of the questions that you guys come up with. So drop them down below in the comment section, let me know if there's anything you want us to answer, and we will do our best to do so. Thank you for tolerating me. Thank you for tolerating the fact that I've now exposed your YouTube Shorts watch history. And thank you for tolerating the video.